de rapporteurs, donc Francesco Mori, qui est chercheur à l'IIT à Gênes, en Italie, de Julien Petré, chargé de recherche INRIA à l'IRISA, c'est ça, qui est examinateur, moi-même qui préside la soutenance aujourd'hui, Philippe Fraisse de l'Université de Montpellier, et enfin les encadrants de la thèse, Olivier Stas, donc directeur de recherche, et Philippe Soir, directeur de recherche également au LAAS. Donc vous avez 45 à 50 minutes de présentation pour nous présenter vos travaux intitulés Using Human Inspired Model for Guiding Robot Locomotion. Please go ahead.
Thank you everybody for coming here today. I'm Christian Vassallo, and today I'm going to present my work, which the title is Using Human-Inspired Model for Guiding Robot Locomotion. In particular, I want to thank the jury, Philippe Fraisse and Francesco Nori, that decided to review my thesis, and Julien Petré, that come here in Toulouse for attending this presentation. We are here because we believe that humanoid robots are the future. I believe that humanoid robots are the future. I believe that one day they will share the environment with us, and they will be able to perform some daily tasks that can be useful, like bringing some object, following a user, or also for some social aspect. But it's not only this, because all the technology that we develop for humanoid robots can be also useful for humans. Let's think about prostheses for the legs, for the arms, or for other part of the body. So I would like that you give a look to this picture. My work is more focused on human-robot interaction. And here we have a humanoid robot that is working in an open space. And the human environment is full of variables, like a worker that are moving at different velocity, static and moving obstacle. And so if we want to implement a robot, humanoid robot in the human environment, it's really, really a challenging problem. My thesis is a part of the European Koroibot project, which aim to improve the humanoid robot capabilities inspired by human. It can be roughly divided in three parts. In the first one, we analyze the human motion for different tasks, like walking on the stairs, walking on a beam, stepping stones. And we try to analyze the cognitive and the mechanical aspect of human during walking. So then we try to define models for human and then extract principles, rules that can be mathematically defined and then transferred to humanoid robot. At LAAS CNRS, we have two humanoid robots, HRP2 and Romeo. But for technical reason, all the implementation that we have done in humanoid robot has been done with HRP2. So, in this thesis, I'm focusing on improve the robot locomotion inspired by human. So in this talk, in the first part, I will show you the work that I've done in collaboration with the mimetic group of INRIA at Rennes. Here we analyze the avoidance strategies of human for avoiding a moving obstacle. We perform two different experiments. In the first one, the robot is moving like a passive object. And in the second one, the robot is adapting its velocity and orientation to avoid as well the walker. So in this part, I focus on the collision avoidance task. I use motion capture system and then try to implement rules to robot to improve their interaction with in the human environment. In the second part of this presentation, I will talk about the collaboration that I've done in the framework of the Koroibot project with our partners of the University of Tübingen. Here, we propose a new method to generate whole-body complex movement using motion primitives that have been extracted from human data. In the last part of this presentation, I will talk about the internal collaboration at LAAS CNRS with Paolo Salaris and Jean-Paul Lamont, And here we implement two novel vision-based control law to steal a robot through a door. So now I'm going to talk about the first part. This work has been done in collaboration with the mimetic group of INRIA, with Anne-Hélène Olivier, Philippe Suer, Almer Etoile, Olivier Stas, and Julien Petret. The first part of this work has been already submitted in Gaeton Posture. It has been recently accepted, and it is currently in press. So, one day, we want that the humanoid robots are in the human environment. And robots are being slowly integrated in the human environments. At least some companies are trying to do so. For example, Aldebaran Robotics are trying to show the Pepper robot in the supermarket at Nantes. We know that Honda is working to implement Asimo in some office, in some environment for welcoming task. But recently, it has been shown also from it has been also shown Atlas that is working in Boston Dynamics, that is working in a factory, try to perform some task, and also at LAAS CNRS, we are working with Airbus to have HRP2 or humanoid robot in production chain. So when we talk about human environment, we should understand that humans interact between each other in different ways. So, and we should, in my opinion, understand the human behavior. I would like that you give a look to this video. Here we have several persons crossing each other. So, and they are moving naturally without aberrant adaptation. And they are able to solve the collision with the others. And what is really interesting is that they don't talk between each other. So there is a kind of non-verbal communication. And when we have to implement robot, of course, the robot doesn't have the same capabilities of human about non-verbal communication. So the question is, how do we plan our working with respect to the other? How can we try to find strategies that we can transfer to humanoid robot? So the key point is that when we share the environment, we have a cooperative and reactive behavior. And this behavior follows some tacit social rules, some implicit social rules. And they are based on nonverbal communication, that is body posture, eyes contact, or the preservation of personal space. So if we want to go a little bit more in detail, what is important is that we have safe interaction. Safe interaction means that we have to avoid collision with other worker, that we have to preserve their personal space, and that we shouldn't be an interfere, a bother. We shouldn't bother the motion of the other, but we should be an active agent of the environment. So the key point to analyze human-human interaction, in my opinion, are three. The first one is observe human behavior. Then we should try to identify the tacit social rules that the human use and translate such rules into practical parameters that can be transferred to robots. There are several work in literature that analyze two persons crossing each other. It has been shown that when two persons are crossing each other, there is a tacit understanding of the crossing order. So what is the crossing order? When I talk about crossing order, I mean who is passing us first or who is giving way. Since the motion, it has been shown that the motion, the behavior of the person is easy to read, worker can predict a great distance the ongoing situation, and then adapt their motion. It has been also shown that the higher priority is to preserve the personal space and avoid collision. This, even if we don't optimize our motion. It has been also shown that collision avoidance is mainly performed in velocity and then orientation. So what about human-robot interaction? So there are not so many work that study a human and a robot crossing each other. It has been shown that human-like behavior, if the robot behaves like in a human-like way, the performance of human-robot collaboration is improved. It has been also shown by many authors that if the robot is following the social rules, their acceptance in the human environment will be improved. So, recently, in June 2016, Carr and Ad proposed a work that is very similar to our one. In their experimental setup, they have two persons working face to face, and then they repeat the same experiment with a robot and with a human. And they conclude that there is no big differences between human-robot interaction and human-human interaction. However, in my opinion, when you work face-to-face, it's more easy to predict how to adapt and solve the collision. And moreover, their robot was moving at 1 meter per second. That is quite slow, because humans walk at 1.4 meter per second. So our work is based on the one of Anne-Hélène Olivier in 2013. So they, in their work, they have two persons walking from two different corners. And at the beginning, they can't see each other. So the window of time that they have to react is really limited. We try to perform the same experimental protocol, the same experiment, but using a robot instead of participant. And our robot is moving at 1.4 meters per second. Actually, our robot is able to arrive until 3 meters per second, but we decide to set some limit. We know the results of the work of Olivier, the Anne-Hélène Olivier. Actually, they discovered that the walker passing as force is not adapting so much, it's just accelerating a little bit if there is risk of collision, and that the walker giving way is the one that contributes more to solve the avoidance task. So the idea is to compare this behavior with the one that we observe if we use a robot. To understand who is adapting more and in which way, velocity or orientation, they use a metric tool that is named MPD. So MPD means minimal predicted distance. It is a function that for each instant of time gives information about the future distance of the closest approach. In other words, it's a function that predicts the risk of collision. The smaller the MPD, the higher the risk of collision. It depends on both position, velocity, orientation of both factors. Here we have an example. In the x-axis we have the time. In the y-axis we have MPD, that is in meter. So when the two actors can start to see each other in TC, the future crossing distance is around 0.3 meter. But in the reaction phase, they perform some adaptation that maybe are in velocity or orientation, and then increase the future distance until 0.6 meter. So if we partially derive this function, we can obtain which one is the main strategy. So in our experimental protocol, we have a walker that is moving straight. He is unaware about the robot behavior. He just knows that a robot could interfere with him, and he should just avoid it and reach the goal. We have some occluding divider screen to hide the robot. So the person has around 3 meters to react. We use the mobile robot Robolab 10. It's quite compact. It's metallic, 30 kilos. And so the participants were quite perturbed by this obstacle. So I'm going to talk about the two experiments. We performed two different experiments. In the first one, the robot is passive. It means that it's moving straight and a constant velocity and is not reacting at the human adaptation. In the second one, instead, the robot is collaborative. So it will try to imitate the human behavior to avoid as well the walker. So in the second experiment, both robot and human will try to avoid the collision. This work is the one that has been submitted and accepted in Gait and Posture. The robot was controlled to move from right to left or from left to right. It was moving straight at constant velocity, 1.4 meter per second. So we measure the velocity of the actor in what we call motion estimate zone. And given the velocity of the actor, given the velocity of the robot, we use a reference behavior of a virtual robot. So we modify actually the initial position of the robot, and we use the real one to track the reference behavior. So we generate specific interaction based on the minimal predicted distance. Sometimes, in some cases, the robot was really close to the collision, but a little bit late with respect to the participant. Sometimes the robot was a little bit in advance. Sometimes was really far for being late or in advance. Or sometimes they were in perfect collision. We extend the concept of SMP, of MPD, what we call sign MPD. So the sign of MPD give information about who is passing as first or who is passing as second. So if SMPD is positive, the robot is late. If the SMPD is negative, the robot is in advance. It's clear that in case we have a change of sign of the MPD, it means that there is a kind of change of strategy. So, for example, the person should pass as first, but decide to give way to the robot. And then we will observe a change of sign. Here we have two examples. In the first one, the participant should pass as first, but decide to decelerate and give way to the robot. In the second case, instead, we have a similar configuration, but the person decides to pass as first. So if we analyze the kinematic data of the case where we have a change of strategy, in particular here, that represent the velocity profile of both participants, we can see that the velocity of the robot during the interaction phase is constant. And we can see that the person decides to decelerate from around 1.8 meter per second at 0.8 meter per second. So, and there is also turning a little bit. So if you analyze the MPD function, we can see that the person should pass more or less around 0.5 meter in advance. But since it accelerates, it passes a second with 0.5 meter. If we partially derive the SMPD function, we see that the main strategy was in velocity and then in also a little bit in orientation. So if you analyze the general behavior of this experiment, each line represents one experiment, we can see that we have two main categories. In the blue one, we have the preservation of the role. It means that there is no change of strategy. If a person should pass as first, in the end, he passes as first. Instead, we have the red category, in which there is a change of strategy. And this change of strategy is systematically when the future risk of collision is around 0 and 0.5 meter. So if there is 0, 0.5 meter of risk of collision, the person decides to decelerate and give way to the robot. This is really interesting because when we analyze the experiment between two walkers, it has never been observed a change of strategy. So they were always predicting the ongoing situation and they were preserving their role. So they know already at great distance if to pass as first or as second. So we have similarities, of course, with human behavior. There has been never collision, so it means that the person are able to predict the ongoing situation. There were no aberrant adaptation in orientation on velocity. It has been also observed that when a person decides to pass in front of the robot, the crossing distance is greater than when you pass behind. And the crossing distance is similar to the one between two walkers. It's around 0.8 meters. So the main differences, I already say, is that in this case, we have a change of strategy that has been not observed between two walkers. The preservation of the role has been preserved in the 72% of the cases. And participants were able to understand that the robot was moving straight at constant velocity. However, we believe because of the lack of experience of interacting with autonomous system, they didn't change so much, they didn't predict so much what to do, and they were always accelerating and give way to the robot. So even if the robot was moving straight, they never accelerate to pass as fast or try to force the crossing order. So now I'm going to talk about the second part, in which the robot is collaborative. We reproduce the same experimental setup. In this case, we have two different behavior of the robot. So if SMPD is negative, so the robot should pass as first, the robot is accelerating and turning to pass ahead. Instead, if SMPD is positive, the robot is deaccelerating and turning to pass behind. We have some predefined behavior, so it's something that we decide already at the beginning of the experiment, but we have also some unpredicted behavior when there are some configuration in which SMPD is equal to zero and the robot decide at the last moment if to pass behind or in front. So here we have two examples. In the first one, the robot give way to the person. And here is accelerating and passing as force. So it's a kind of reproduction of the human behavior. So if you analyze the kinematic data, in particular the velocity, we can see that the velocity of the actor, it is the black one, is not so much perturbated. The robot is deaccelerating and accelerating in the case of SMPD positive or negative. But what is really interesting is that in this case, the risk of collision was really high, 0.5 meter and 0.2. There is no change of strategy, but they just increase the future distance and they preserve their role. And this is really similar to the one that we observe between two humans. So if you analyze the global behavior, we observe again some change of strategy from positive to negative. So in some cases, the person decides to give way to the robot, but this is only the 5% of the cases. In the 93% of the cases, the role has been preserved. And this is really, really similar to what happened between two humans. So if we compare the result to the one of the previous studies, we have 72% of preservation of the role. If the robot is collaborative, we have 93.6% of the cases. The participant adaptation are smoother. There are no big deceleration or acceleration to preserve their role. And this behavior is much more similar to the one between two humans because the person can't predict a priori the robot behavior. And so they are taking decision line in real time. And the role assignment, so who is passing first, who is passing a second, depends on both participants because robot and the walker are active agent. So we conclude that if the robot is behaving human-like, so the performance of human-robot collaboration is improved. And this was observed also from Kato in 2015. We think that we identify some key behaviors for controlling the robot and have a robot collaborating with human. The behavior of the the collaborative strategies of the robot bring the person to behave more naturally. And we use some simplified behavior because we didn't really generate trajectories that are really, really similar to the one of the human. We just use trajectories that have been extracted from observed behavior. But with this simplified behavior, we improved the human-robot collaboration. So the idea in the future, so based in, this, in the results that we obtained, the idea is, okay, maybe we can try to improve these trajectories and try to find a behavior that is a little bit more similar to the one of the human and see if we can still improve our work. And of course, we would like to improve this observed behavior in humanoid robot and then compare the results. What is interesting of this work is that we are not trying to minimize some criteria or we didn't define it like an optimization problem, but we just use observed behavior and they are sufficient to obtain interesting results. So now I'm going to talk about the collaboration that I've done with our colleague of Tübingen. In with this work, I'm not the main investigator, and together Maximilian Naveau and Olivier Stas at LAAS CNRS, we work to do the real implementation, the implementation of the real robot. This work has been presented in IROS 2015, and it is currently under review with the Robotics Autonomous System. So the idea here is that we want to generate whole body motion using motion primitives that are extracted by human data. And the task is working to grasp. There are several work related to working to grasp. For example, Olivier Stas in 2008 proposed a system based on walking plus vision to reach a ball and grasp the ball. With Asimo, they proposed methods for learning. So the robot was observing the user. It was trying to reproduce the same motion of grasping. And in the DARPA challenge, there have been proposed a different work. Here we have, for example, Atlas, that used an architecture that was able to self-localize the robot with respect to the target and then generate feasible footsteps, avoiding collision with the environment and also self-collision. And also common, it was driven by vision to reach the valve. All this work share a common feature. They are working to grasp, working to reach the goal, but they are divided in subtasks. It means that one task is walking and the other task is grasping. So in our work, the idea is that we want to generate whole body motion and walking and grasping should be performed as a unique task. So we want to solve them together. And we want to do it inspired by human. So in this video, we have a human. It is a production of an avatar. It is reproducing the human motion. So the idea is to extract motion primitives and use these motion primitives to generate reactive walking. So if, for example, the avatar is reaching the drawer and we change the position of the drawer, we should be able in real time to generate new feasible motion to reach the target. And of course, we want to implement this work in HRP2. So our colleague, our partners of Tübingen, their contribution has been to generate this reactive walking based on motion primitive and to extract motion primitive. Our work was to implement this work on the real robot and see if it was feasible. So this is a control scheme of the work that we have done. In the black one, the black box represents the work that has been done right now. And the red one are the future work. So it has been not implemented yet. So they use an anechoic demixing model to extract source signal. So what it means? They have trajectories. these trajectories have been extracted from human data. And we know that the trajectories can be seen like a combination and a translation of movement that are shifted and combined in a, they are shifted and combined together, and these movements are more simple. So they are simplified movement. And so they try to generate the trajectories using simplified motion. With the mixing model, they are able to extract some signals. And these signals are periodic and non-periodic. So with only five source signals, they use only five source signals, they are able to generate the trajectories of humans. So they use this system. Since it's complicated to compute together periodic and non-periodic signal, they use this limit cycle attractor. This is like a vector field. And so it doesn't matter which is the configuration. This system is always able to find a stable solution to generate exactly the trajectory that we want. So using this system, we can say that they are able to generate dynamic motion primitive, and then they combine this dynamic motion primitive to generate reactive motion. So we try to implement the motion that they did with the simulation, the real robot, and it is not feasible. It's not feasible because mainly for the leg, because the motion that was reproduced for the legs was not not dynamically stable. So what we have done, we divided the trajectory in two parts, the low body part and the upper body part. So we use the linear and angular velocity of the pelvis, and we send it to the working pattern generator. The working pattern generator, how we know, he considers a simplified model for biped walking. And given the, and it computes based on the linear and angular velocity of the pelvis, the stable steps in a horizon. Because if we perform a step, we want that also the next one is feasible. So we should produce steps that are stable for the next solution. That's why it's computing steps in an horizon. And so it's providing center of mass as MP trajectories. But since we are not taking account the upper body, this table could become not stable. This working could become not stable. So using the dynamic filter that has been developed by Maximilian Naveau at LAAS, we take in consideration also the upper body. We compensate the error in the center of mass as MP trajectories. A dynamic filter, we consider the upper body like a perturbation of the stable walking, and we generate dynamically stable walking. So the center of mass as MP trajectory will be sent to the to a generalized inverse kinematics with stack of tasks that provide the joint position, velocity, acceleration, and then we send them to the real robot. In the future, the idea is that, okay, we send this motion to the robot, so we will use the sensor data to reach, to extend our training set for the learning process that has been done by our colleague. Because the idea is, if you are able to learn, to generate trajectories that have been learned from feasible data, of course, the result will be more feasible and more interesting for our robot. So here we have the video. Well, in the left one, there is a simulation with OpenHRP, and the same motion is performed by the humanoid robot. Here is reaching the target with only two steps. And what we do here is actually to move the target and generate online the new motion. So we perform all the trajectories five times in a row, and all the motions was feasible and the robot was not falling. So actually we conclude that it is possible with the architecture that we propose to transfer human data and generate a stable motion using motion motion primitives. And it has been possible, especially because we have a strong tool, our working pattern generator, our dynamic filter, that are able to take trajectories that are not feasible and make them feasible. So now the future step is, okay, we modify a little bit these trajectories to obtain stable results, and now we want to see if we learn from stable results what are the performance. So this is exactly what they say. And so another thing that we want to do is now what we have done is that the trajectories are computed online, and we would like to modify a little bit the structure to generate motion in real time. So in real time, we want that the target is moved, and we want to generate them in real time. The approach proposed, we think that it can do it because the computational time is really fast. So now I'm going to talk about the last work that has been done in collaboration with Paolo Salais and Jean-Paul Lamont. This work has been submitted and accepted in ICRA 2015 and in Transaction Robotics. In this work, I work next to Paolo for the implementation part. So there are several work about vision-based control to steer a robot through a door. Usually, there is a combination of sensors like camera and 2D laser range, or vision and ultrasonic sensor information. Also for humanoid robots, there are some work, some methods, but usually they are defined more like a solution of different subtasks. So, for example, I should reach the target, I should reach the door, and then I should pass through the door. In our work, thanks to a new canonical parametrization, we are able to compute the control inputs directly from the data visual in the camera image, and we solve this task as a unique task. And it is really interesting because we don't need an observer to localize the robot with respect to the door, and we just use the camera information. So we have a door, and we have an holonomic system equipped with a pinhole camera model. We have two landmarks attached to the vertical support of a door, and they are at the same height. We propose two different approaches: a control law in elliptic coordinate and a control law in bipolar coordinate. So the idea behind this work is that if the robot is moving between the two landmarks, so it's going through the door, the two landmarks in the image plane are asymmetric and equally distant. So if we respect this condition, they can be seen like two foci, and they are always equally distant in this image plane. So if this condition is respected, we observe that the vehicle move along an hyperbola with constant velocity. So we know that there are more hyperbola passing through a door, and we know that the two foci can be also used to represent an ellipse. So the position of the robot can be identified by an ellipse, an hyperbola, and the orientation of the robot can be found using the bare angle between the heading of the robot and the tangent to the hyperbola. So the results that we obtain in simulation show us that the robot, this control law is really strong to the noise. And even if the robot was far, The controller was steering the robot through the door. However, if you give a look here, for example, it's easy to see, the controller is not bringing the robot exactly to the middle of the door. And it is a problem, because if you are moving along this hyperbola, we could actually crash with the vertical support. So we propose the bipolar coordinates that are always based on the concept of an hyperbola passing through the door. We know that given the position of the robot, we can always find a circle that passes between the position of the robot and the true landmark. And given the black circle, we can always find its perpendicular one, that is the blue one, which its tangent is passing between the robot and the middle of the black circle. So here we can find the position of, we can identify the position of the robot using the black circle, the blue circle, and again the bare angle between the heading of the robot and the tangent to the hyperbola. So this system of bipolar coordinates with appropriate control law can be seen like a vector field, where the attractive point is the middle of the door. So now we change a little bit the control law. We want to have a path following in a vector field. So the idea is to minimize the error in order that the robot is following the vector field. And what we obtain in simulation is that the robot is always driving exactly to the middle of the door. Here is a really nice example in simulation. We are in a corridor in a really constrained environment, and so the control law is bringing the robot to the middle and then it's going straight. And it is solved as a Unix task, so we don't have two different subtasks. However, this control law is sensitive to noise. So now the idea is, okay, we want to try it in the real robot and see what happens. This is my contribution. We have the same robot that we used in the first part, equipped with a wireless camera. The quality of the camera was really poor and with big distortion. So I use OpenCV and Viz, that are two vision library to trade images. So with the OpenCV, I detect the landmark in the image, and then I send the information to Visp that provide method for the tracking. So we send the information to another software that control the robot, validate the data that we have, decide which landmark is left, which one is right, and then compute the control input to the real robot. So this is the video that we proposed for iCrash 2015. So here we have our robot, and the first one is in a bipolar coordinate. We can see that the robot is moving around 0.5 meters per second, is converging to the middle of the door, and then is going straight. Instead, the second control is in elliptic coordinate. The robot is moving much more faster at the beginning, around 0.8 meters per second. And the controller drives the robot to the door. So, and then it's converging, of course, but it doesn't guarantee that it's going exactly to the middle. So if you analyze the real trajectories with the simulated one, we observe a similar behavior. Of course, given the limited field of view, we couldn't have starting positions that are too much lateral. Here it's clear that, for example, with the bipolar coordinate, we are exactly in the middle. And instead, here with the elliptic coordinate, for example, the light blue is not perfectly oriented. So the idea is, okay, we can try to combine these strategies. When the robot is far, we use elliptic coordinate because it's robust to noise. And when the robot is close to the door, we use bipolar coordinate because we know that it steers the robot in the middle of the door. So it has been also observed that these trajectories are similar to the one of humans. This work has been proposed by Arash Valeta. actually, in this experiment, they have a walker starting from a fixed position orientation, and they should arrive to fixed targets with fixed orientation. And so we can see that the shape is not, of course, identical. It could be also interesting to analyze the trajectories of the combined method, but in somehow it's similar to the one observed in human. So the idea now is to extend the control law because we would like to have the turning effect, so to use a pan-tilt platform to turn also the camera. And we would like to implement this control in the humanoid robot CRP2 using a working pattern generator that we developed at LAAS CNRS. So to conclude, in this thesis, I analyzed the locomotion from robot and human point of view. So I tried to improve the robot locomotion inspired by human. In the first two parts, I identify human working strategies for collision avoidance tasks. And we try, and we also observe that if the robot is moving in a human-like behavior, this improves the interaction with human. In the second work, we have been able to provide a dynamical stable working using motion primitive extracted by human data. Of course, we have to extend it, but this is a first result. And with the work done with Paolo Salaris, we propose two novel vision-based controls that are able to see the robot through a door using only the information from the camera. So, based on my research, we could actually, in my opinion, try to transfer this observed behavior in humanoid robot and see if it's really working, if it's really improving the humanoid robot capabilities. Of course, we are just working between a configuration in which there are just two participants, but it could be interesting to extend this research with robots in a crowded environment. So to see how a robot can really interact if there are more persons. How already say, now we would like to, about the work of done with Tübingen, we would like to extend the architecture in order that the motion is regenerated in real time and extend the training set for the learning. And the end, the last word done with Paolo, we would like to implement the vision-based control law in the humanoid robot CRP2. Of course, we know that when we have a robot walking, it's much more easier to use the landbar because there is all the noise given to the walk. But we want to see if it is robust enough. And so we would like just to compare also the trajectory that we obtained with the one of human. It could be really interesting. So I conclude here my talk and thank you for your attention.
Anyway, good job. The presentation was very good and definitely added something to the thesis. I wrote down a few questions. I start with the very first one. It's a standard one, but I always want to hear new ideas on that. You cited humanoids as opposed to maybe mobile robots or something else, and it seems like all the time you are referring to the fact that humanoid will be sort of the end of your work in the end, in comparison with mobile robots. Why do you believe so much in humanoids and not in something else?
So, I believe in humanoids because, especially for biped humanoids, because contrary to just mobile robots, they could be able to walk or go in an environment which just mobile robots can't. And given their future, like given the harm and also this kind of aspect that are really similar to human, we could actually try to reproduce the same task of human with humanoid robots, that we can't do it with a mobile robot. Of course, mobile robot can be used for other purpose, and maybe it should be easier to use them, for example, for vigilance or for open space like an airport. But if you want to use a humanoid, if you want to do some tasks in a more specific way, really similar to human, it could be more interesting for me to use humanoid robots. But it's also like for the development of prostheses or part of the technology that you use for humanoid robots that can be useful also for human.
And this paves the way to the next question. There are recent theories in neuroscience suggesting that it's very important that two interacting agents share the same motor repertoire, so the same capabilities. Talking about the first part of your thesis, you simplified the task in a very sketched environment where you have dots that move in a plane with a certain velocity, and then you compute what will be the collision time or collision distance, and then you make assumptions about that.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think is the role of the other variables that you left out of this analysis? Is it important, for example, the phase of the gait when you start seeing the person you will be colliding with? Is it important that he's on the left foot as opposed to being on the right foot? Is there a role about something else, or is really everything that matters is the position on the plane and the velocity of the two dots?
At the beginning, the idea was to analyze the whole body organization during collision avoidance. And luckily, we didn't have the time. But actually, I agree with you that now what we have observed is just an observed behavior, so like top level. But it could be also interesting to analyze the more the mechanical aspect of the human when we avoid the collision. So how we really do it, if how we perform the steps, how we turn the shoulder. So of course, this can be interesting. It could be also too related to the observed behavior right now. And this, of course, could be a perspective for this thesis. So don't analyze only the trajectories, as you say, but also the velocity and the orientation, but also the organization of the body.
Can you also comment in particular not only on the robot position and the robot structure, but also do you think that the robot will require to understand what the human is doing, what is the footstep phase, what are the situation? Do you think that will be important? In which situation that will be important?
So you mean about the behavior of human depending on the frequency of steps and the body?
The frequency or really the, if it is, for example, if we are colliding, you are coming from the left-hand side,
mm-hmm.
I'm the robot, you are the person I will interact with. Do I need to know if you are stepping with the right foot and the left foot, in which phase of the gait cycle you are, or that will be completely useless? What do you think about that?
I think, in my opinion, that in case of really high risk of collision, it is not so useful because the robot can't really react so fast, and so maybe we could have other kind of approach, like stopping the robot and letting the walker to behave to solve the collision. Because if we have to observe all these variables in real time, it could become really, really difficult in terms of computational time.
I rephrase the question: what if two persons will collide? Do you think that if we are really close, I will take into account if you're stepping with the left foot or
yes,
the right foot?
In my opinion, yes.
Then don't you think that as in the future this will be useful in humanoids to know exactly not only that the person is there with a certain velocity, but also to know what phase of the gait cycle is exactly in order to take my steps.
Yeah, because we do it. So if you are able to understand the situation of the person, of course we can try to behave and react in this direction. So to answer to your question, I think yes, it is important to understand in which phase of the gait cycle we are, because humans do it. And so maybe this feature could be also useful for robots. But I already say it could be complicated to take all these variables in consideration.
Yeah, I agree it could be complicated. But I think it's... I would say that if you want to find new perspective to your work, that could be one direction. That's my feeling.
Okay.
Because I really believe that it makes a big difference in which... position your body is and which position your foot is in order to understand what you can expect from the other. Because avoiding on in one direction or in the other direction might be very different depending on the foot you are putting your weight on.
Of course. Because
so this,
I
think,
right.
might be interesting. Talking about the comparison between the first and the second part, I think you really took two different strategies. In one case, you did an extensive study of literature in walking behaviors and collision avoidance, and there seemed to be plenty of literature on that, and you started from that, and then you took some models, you translated them into equations, and you put these equations into the robot, and then you checked that the behavior was human-like, or better, was allowing a better human-robot interaction. In the other case, the approach was very different. You take a lot of trajectories, you sort of do some magic, algorithm, which is the anechoic mixture model, and then you come out with something that is somehow learned from data, is not something that you made models about, it's just something you trust would be a good model. And you use this information for then synthesizing the robot behavior. Which one of the two approaches you like most, and why you think one is better than the other, or what do you think is the future for synthesizing or for modeling human data, human movements?
Of course, there are two models, totally different, approach totally different. In my opinion, the interesting idea could be to combine them. So in the one, we are some observed behavior, and the other, and so we are controlling like an observed behavior, and the other one instead, we have more, we are generating whole body motion. You are talking about the work done within Tübingen, right? And, for example, let's analyze the trajectory that they perform when there is a person approaching the target, you know? It could be also interesting to analyze the behavior in terms of velocity and orientation, similar to what we did for the collision avoidance, and then try to find a link. How we decelerate, how do we approach to some target, and so to combine this mixture, model that they have done to generate steps with the one that, so to generate like the two methods, one that generates steps foot and stable motion, the other one is like more analyze the behavior. So in my opinion, there are two opposite approach, but they can be, of course, try to be correlated somehow.
Continuing on this topic, I see that there might be a scalability problem. I'm trying to be more clear. If you take one single movement, like in this case, path planning of two walking or two intersecting trajectories, then you can start building a lot of theoretical ideas, you look at particular indicators like the collision time, or what was called that, minimum distance index. You can definitely investigate all possible indicators or try what we call features of a specific movement, so specific quantities that you believe are fundamental for that specific movement. But if you scale down to many different actions, not only walking, but also opening drawers, moving a table together, if you want really to be general in the way of describing the action, being able to describe many different actions, the first approach will not be feasible because it's impossible to consider all possible tasks. And this is probably why people start looking at data-driven approaches as opposed to model-based approaches. So I would say that what they did in Tübingen is more data-driven. You just take data, you don't really want to know what is behind the data. You just want to find something that will represent the data in a meaningful sense. In the other case, you try to model things, try to understand what are the key ingredients, what are the features of that particular movement, and then trying to get this feature and then use that in the model of the behavior. So I think that's a question that we need somehow to solve. We need to understand, do we want to go for a model-based approach? We want to do purely data-driven approach. Again, well, mixing the two, do you think it will be possible in this sense? Or
it would be interesting. It could be interesting, but of course, as you say, we should understand if to go in one direction or to the other. And if you should say which one is more interesting, maybe I will say the work that has been done in Tübingen, which we generate stable walking. But this work has been done for a specific task, and we are not sure that it is working for other lot of tasks. Instead, with the approach that I have done, with observed behavior, it's easier to analyze a different task and try to again find the behavior in more general way. So it's true, maybe with the approach of Tübingen and we are able to generate stable motion, it's feasible, we implement it in humanoid robot, but it takes a lot of time. You know, every time we should record new motion, we should generate, we should find parameters for the mixture model, we should find the translation, we should find a source signal. So it takes a lot of time, it's a lot of turning. So that we don't have instead in the observed behavior.
Concerning the last part, this is a rather technical one. I didn't get at the beginning. I liked the fact that you were saying that it's a sort of image plane. You're using image plane features, and that's what you need. But I had the impression in your presentation that instead you need to also sense the position of the robot in the bipolar coordinates. So my question is this true? And if this is true, how do you sense the position of the robot in these bipolar coordinates?
So actually from the image plane, we have the position of the landmark. And since it's a pinhole camera model, we can find a canonical form which give us control law to see the robot through this hyperbola. And so from this canonical form, it can be seen by mathematics, we have, if like it's we have a canonical form, which it is, if it is fixed one parameter, we obtain the hyperbola in which the robot belongs. And if we fix another parameter, we obtain the ellipse where the robot belong. So we just use this canonical form to find, given like the foci, to find the position of the robot. I can show you.
What about the orientation?
The orientation instead is just at very angle. We know that the robot belong to an hyperbola, so we know that it is in a point and there is a tangent of this hyperbola. So we have the heading of the robot, and we want to minimize the error. We want that this angle is going to zero. So we want that the robot's heading is aligned with the tangent of the hyperbola. And with this very angle, we identify also the orientation of the robot. I can show you a slide for it, it's easier. So, here we have the position of the robot, and it is the hyperbola in which the robot belongs. So we have the tangent to this hyperbola, and we have the heading of the robot. So if the robot is moving on the hyperbola, it's like a path following following an hyperbola. So we know that the robot is going through the landmark. And so the idea, we identify the orientation with this very angle, the angle between the tangent and the heading.
So to recover the angle, you need to start moving. Is that the case? I didn't get it.
If I want the angle...
If you want to know the angle with respect to the tangent, you need to start moving or not? Or is something you read in the image plane?
No, I read it in the image plane. Okay. I can compute this angle.
Okay, and it's so the angle of the robot with respect to the hyperbola is given by some image features.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that probably requires to look at the details that I haven't. Mm.
I avoided the details because otherwise it was too long.
Me too, in your thesis, I have to be honest. In this particular part, I didn't enter into the very details.
But the main idea is that we can identify the position, give a hyperbola and ellipse, because we have landmarks that are represented like two foci, and so then we have this very angle, and we want to minimize it, and we want that the robot is following this hyperbola. But to know in which part of the hyperbola we are, we need an ellipse. Okay, so every time that the robot is moving, we can identify its position.
One final question. This is rather provocative. It seems to me that this last part is the one that with less connection to humans.
Mm-hmm.
Even if I think it's a nice work, it has some interesting feature. So it's not really a question, but the idea of connecting this with humans, with human behavior in walking, was the starting point, or was like something that came up in the end?
It came up in the end.
So it just did some literature search and find out that something.
The idea was the method. So we know we use only vision, and the idea is okay, we try to use only vision in a human-like way. In the end, but really in the end, we discover that these trajectories were similar to the one observed in human.
Okay, I think I'm done with questions. Thanks again.
Thank you.
There are very interesting idea, and the topics of human-robot interactions, it's very interesting and definitely understudied in the robotics community. Thanks.
Thank you, Francesco. I have some questions about your presentation. I really appreciate your presentation. It was very clear, and now I understand the third part on the learning aspect. Okay, it's thank you for this presentation, and I would like to thank also the supervisor to invite me and to this committee. And now I have a question about your work, and can we go to the slide 10, please?
Of course.
Because I have a question about the your assumption, and mm-hmm. because you base your observation first of all on on experimentation on two humans, right? Mm-hmm. But in this picture, we can see that the human can see the other and each other, and can predict
yes
the movement and the motion at the beginning. And you didn't take this environment mm-hmm. to reproduce the same behavior in your experimentations, because there is, I don't remember, a wall or something mm-hmm. hiding the mobile robot. And why did you choose to modify the experimental condition mm-hmm. Between the human and robot? Based on the first observation on two humans.
So actually, the experimental protocol that you have seen is not the first one. So we try different experimental protocol. In the first one, the really first one, there were no occluding wall.
Okay.
And it was too easy for the person to predict what to do. Yeah. We also try to use two robots. We also try to have a more similar situation to human. But since there were no occluding wall, the person was predicting a huge distance what to do. It was too easy to react.
Yes, to control the velocity and to make sure that...
Exactly, because since the person was modifying his velocity too much, he was adapting already since 6-7 meters, because he was seeing the robot moving at the beginning. At the beginning, moreover, the robot is accelerating. It was not exactly the kind of interaction that we wanted. We also tried to use, before this robot, another one, that it was TurtleBot. We tried to use also more TurtleBot together, but actually the robot was not so fast, up to 0.8 meter per second. And so we conclude that if the robot was not fast enough, for the person it was easy to...
Okay.
To avoid, and if he was able to see since long space, it was even easy to predict too early. We wanted to limit his interaction time, in order that the motion of the person was really perturbated.
Okay, and did you try to reproduce this protocol between two humans by using a cloning?
The same.
This one. To compare the impact of these modifications to the behavior between two humans, because I think it will impact as well the conclusion maybe of your work. This is why I would like to clarify this part.
Didn't try the same experimental protocol between two humans. It could be also interesting to try to perform the same experiment between two humans and then redo it with a robot. It would be, of course, interesting. We didn't do it. We just tried to replicate really the experimental protocol that has been done. Moreover, this work has been done in the same gymnasium, I guess so, no? So the experimental protocol, the configuration was really similar.
Okay, thank you. And I have a question about the conclusion about two humans. Does the empathy play a role to interact for two humans? I mean the empathy to think about the other, what he's doing, and do you think that there is a... Because your conclusion... Or the second part of your contribution is, okay, if we have a behavior, a human-like behavior, it works better than a passive movement. But, okay, we can maybe have a conclusion about the interaction between two humans, because the empathy can produce the human extract information from his own experience, and if we know how the robot works, even if it's not a human-like approach, maybe it will improve the interaction as well. Cameron, I don't know if I'm clear.
No, you have been clear. In the first work, we observed that the participant, after a few trials, five trials, they understood what the robot was doing. Okay. So they know exactly that the robot was going straight at a constant velocity. However, they didn't anticipate so much. They didn't use this information to improve their behavior.
Okay.
I think, in my opinion, is that when we walk, so we expect that the other doing the same. And this kind of readability of the motion help us to adapt our motion predicting ongoing situation.
Okay.
If the robot is moving straight, It's similar to a situation of the on the street. There is somebody passing with a bike, and the bike is not reacting. And so it's strange, because maybe it's like expecting that we are reacting, and we are waiting that he is reacting as well. And so there is a kind of conflict situation. And I think that in this case, we have a similar situation. The robot was not reacting, and sometimes the person was afraid about what to do. Because you say, okay, this robot is not reacting, what should I do? Okay, yeah. Stop. I give way.
Okay.
Instead, when the robot was cooperative and it was taking decision as well, the person decide what to do according to the robot behavior. Because, mm-hmm. Okay, I don't know exactly what to do, but the robot is starting to pass behind, so I keep moving.
Okay. A last question about the active behavior. You compute the SMPD. Slide 17. Maybe.
Slide 17.
Yes, 17. Maybe. Ah, yes. Yes. Okay. Yes. Okay. And did you compute these parameters in real time along the trajectory or just once?
So it was predefined.
It's predefined.
It's predefined.
Okay, there is no changes. Okay, for example, if the velocity of the human is changing and during the before crossing, mm-hmm. there is no change.
Exactly, there is no change. The only configuration with it change is when SMPD is equal to zero.
Okay.
Because in this case, we move the initial position of the robot to be a little bit late or in advance, and when we decide to turn or accelerate and accelerate. Okay. But we add also some configuration in which the SMPD was equal to zero. So the robot was analyzing the human velocity, and then it was deciding where to move to have perfect collision. But since there was perfect collision, okay. Actually we don't have, we are not in these cases. So it was analyzing again at the last moment, the robot position, he was assuming that the person didn't change so much his velocity, and okay. He was adapting. So you are right, it could be really interesting to analyze all the time the velocity of the robot and all the velocity of the participant, and then have a reactive motion in real time.
Yeah.
Of course, this could be an extension, because it has been difficult for publishing. The idea was, okay, we have two human interacting with each other. We want to now modify a little bit experimental protocol and use a robot moving in passive way. And then we can have a collaborative behavior. This will be submitted next month, again, Gate and Posture.
Okay.
And of course, we can extend this work. There are already some work in simulation, which there are two agents, one that should be avoid the other. And so it could be interesting to implement these strategies in the real robot and also compare the if between pre-planned behavior or real-time behavior, there is some difference.
Yeah, of course.
Mm-hmm. Because, of course, real-time behavior requires much more time, much more computational time. And so we can see if we can use a compromise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because my question was about the if it's maybe possible to observe a kind of instability, but it's not possible in that case.
In that case, not possible.
But sometimes when crossing people, we are freezing because we stop because mm-hmm. we don't find
the solution
because the other is doing the same
yeah,
action at the same time in real time, and this is why there is a conflict.
It's a conflict situation.
Okay, it was my question, but it's not maybe relevant in that case.
It was we try also to replicate actually this behavior. When the robot was collaborative, actually sometimes it happened. In fact, that's why we have this change of strategy that is 5%. Because the robot and the person were doing the same.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was, okay, and the person also was really a little bit unprepared, and so he decided to stop.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. a question about the slide 34, about the contribution, yes, the control scheme. Okay, actually, your contribution is not the learning part, this is the other part. You take the reference, yes, and adapt the reference to under the constraint of balance and dynamic constraint and so on. And my question is about, okay, can we remove the learning part and replace by a database of motion or something like this?
But I think the idea is this one.
This is the idea, okay.
Once that we have a database of motion that are feasible, we don't need to do again the learning part.
Yeah.
We have a library of motion primitives that can be combined to generate. So this part is more to build this data.
Okay, this is just to illustrate the capabilities of your, okay. Now it's it's clear, and okay. And a question about this part, can we imagine that we can, if I have two motions of grasping an object, I don't know, and I need to have a motion between them. Can we imagine to synthesize a new movement and use this pattern?
But since it's a model predictive control, if we have a change of motion, for example, what we are computing now should be feasible also for the future. Of course, if the two actions are totally different, maybe it could be not feasible, but it's also like for human, no? We can't change so much our behavior when we are working.
Okay. Thanks. And last, just a comment on your last contribution. I don't remember. Okay, it was very very clear, and I really appreciate that. It's very elegant in mathematically speaking, and I really appreciate the contribution. It's very promising in my opinion, and I have a question about the extension of that method, because it's dedicated for passing through the door, but can we imagine to use it for controlling a mobile robot or humanoid in all way or something like this? Because in your assumption, this is for a door only, because this is a line and your geometric controller is based on that. But can we imagine to
for collision avoidance, you
not only to follow a wall or something?
So if you have, for example, since we need two landmarks.
Okay.
We just need two landmarks that are the same height. This is the assumption. So for example, if I want to go through a corridor, I could have a kind of sequential landmark and then going to the middle. Of course, if you should take in consideration that there are obstacles and... if there are obstacles, maybe it's not a big problem, because if you have, for example, that this corridor is smaller, we can have another landmark, and so it's moving to again, going to the center. The problem is that we have, when we have a moving obstacle, that becomes complicated.
Okay.
So we can use it for the corridor or for other constrained environment identified by two landmark, but if you should extend all, if you should consider all the variable, I think we can't use only this.
And you talk about in your presentation, say that maybe you would extend this controller to use it on humanoid robot. I have a question about that, because I think with the humanoid robot, the velocity is not maybe constant, or it's more difficult. There is a large variation.
Yeah, that problem, yes.
Is it an issue?
Yes, of course, it's an issue. We should take it in consideration in the control law, because actually we have this oscillation. And so I remember that we talked with this with Paolo Salaris. So if you have this oscillation, of course, maybe the controller is trying to minimize also this oscillation that can't be really minimized, because it's implicit of the robot. And so we should find, of course, a way to mathematically ignore this oscillation and try to find a maybe instead to have like a, just a trajectory, okay, a kind of blend of trajectories.
So not okay, I see.
This could be an idea. So it's like a kind of vector field. It's not exactly converging to this direction, and in this vector field, maybe the oscillation could be taken in account. So it's this could be an idea.
Okay, and last question about the slide 50, the last one, maybe not. You mentioned that you plan to extend the study for what in a cold environment. In that case, normally you will see everything and can predict people and the motion of people or what?
This is an idea of study that I had in the last part of my thesis. The idea will be, yes, we don't have occluding wall in this case, but we have much more person. And actually there are different studies on a crowd situation.
Okay.
So we should try to replicate the same experiment exactly how we did for two person crossing each other. And then try to see. It's an open question. It's a future work that I could do in my research. So it's not something that is now, but it could be done in the future.
Okay, thank you very much. I really appreciate your presentation and the answer. Now, maybe Julien, you could take.
So thank you. I would like also to congratulate you on the clarity of your presentation, and it gives some illustration to this manuscript, which is appreciable. And so I still have a couple of questions for you. So first of all, I would like just to have a general question about the first part of your work, because as I participated to the study, so I want it's quite clear for me what we did. But as Philippe, I have a question about this crowded environment you are pushing in the future work. I would like to ask you what would you expect from such a study? So imagine that you test a robot behavior in a crowd, right? This is the purpose of such an experiment. So what would you like test exactly? What would you like to
do? For example, we could have, for example, just two person that are for each side, and they are crossing in a perpendicular way similar to the robot. So two from right to left and two from left to right, and the robot is going exactly in the middle. And I would like to see if using the trajectory, the strategy that we observe, this strategy could be implemented and see the result. Because for one human, we define them, it's quite easy. But if, for example, after that there is another human, the question is it optimal what we are doing in a crowded situation or not? So I didn't think yet about an experimental protocol, but the idea was just have more participants and have more variable. Of course, what will be the robot behavior? I don't know, but I think that if we follow the human behavior, it could be like going to left, right, so it could be much more reactive. And actually, I didn't think so much about it, but the idea is to find if what we are using for one person is optimal also in the case of other person.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but two persons is still not a crowd.
No.
So imagine that you have many, many people around the robot. So one classical problem is that then the solution space for the robot is empty. I mean, there is no motion that won't cause a risk of collision with people around it. So what do you think would be a good behavior for the robot?
For sure, if we follow the social rules, if one person is going face to face, we should pass left to the person, so right is right. And in the other case, when they are perpendicular, we should check if he's in advance or in later. What could be the best solution? The problem is that it could be like considered like a subtask, because each person is a task, but these tasks are correlated between themselves, and so what they should find is a solution for the most possible number of tasks. For sure, if I put a robot in a crude environment, also the other people should adapt to the robot, because it's what we do, no? We just don't adapt to only one person, but to multiple persons. It's like a prediction of what we are doing now and what we will do next to the other, with the other one. I don't know exactly the answer to this question, because it was a question that I had in mind, and I would like to work in this direction to extend the work, but I didn't analyze it really in detail, how I can do the experimental protocol, or how, what could be the interesting behavior to observe, what the robot could do. So I don't know exactly what to answer, but it could be interesting to know.
Okay. So now, concerning the second part of your work, your collaboration with Tübingen. So I think I have quite the same feeling that the other reviewer and of your thesis is that I made the exercise of writing down what you do with the motion data. So you retarget it, you make a first adaptation, and then you cut and you rescale twice and etc. So the question is, what really remains from the initial data?
The reference behavior, I guess. The reference behavior. So, of course, the human motion were not, it's a kind of imitation, in my opinion, because what we really replicate is the upper body, because the lower body is totally different, it's controlled by the working pattern generator. So actually, the main contribution, I think, it's not to replicate the human motion, because there are several work about imitation, but to extract this motion that can, this motion primitive, they can generate the whole body trajectories. So
even though it's not exactly your part, can you tell a bit more about the motion samples that were given to this?
The simplified motion?
To the mixture model directly. So when in Tübingen they recorded this motion of walking and grasping, what do you need? Do you need someone that performs the motion in the same way, or do you need variation of this action? What do you need exactly?
They had just one actor performing 10 times the same task.
But you said at the end of your study, you say, okay, the 10 motions were not enough in our case. I don't remember exactly for which reason, but what was lacking here in the initial database?
No, actually, they had just 10 trajectories of a person.
Yeah.
They didn't record the same behavior of other, the same task for other person. So I think that they should extend this part, because just 10 trajectories of one person is not sufficient to generalize a behavior. And the question is...
That was my question. So it's not enough to generalize. This was a problem.
I think it's not enough to generalize. I think that we need to have at least... 10-20 person.
So to finally, person performing the same task in different ways.
Exactly, because we have different style, and so the idea is to also to compare them and to try to understand which one is better.
But do you think that if it's more general about the task, that would help the robot then to adapt this task to
new
environments or?
What I observed when we did a real experiment is that, for example, the upper body was, the grasping was not really precise. I think that because we didn't have enough trajectories, because maybe the learning part about the grasping was not so rich, was not so, because the idea was more about to generate a stable working. So in my opinion, if you have more data, of course the learning could be better. Of course we can't have, moreover if you have the data of the same actor, we risk to have a learning that is too specific for this person. That's why usually learning we have different, a data set is composed by different kind of similar trajectories, but different, you know, different style, just to generalize. So yes, to answer your question, I think that they should improve this part. We should have a generalized motion. To have a generalized motion could improve, we don't know a priori, but in my opinion, it's a better approach to do the learning.
And at some point you say in your manuscript that it would be better for you to start from feasible motions.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe it's a matter also of mocap processing. What if you adapt earlier, you adapt this motion to the robot? I'm not sure it makes sense, but you first use imitation technique to project the motion on the robot, and then you learn from these motions. Would that be helpful?
Because actually with the imitation, so we transfer this motion to the robot, but it's not feasible.
Yeah, but to transfer after the model has generalized the motion, right?
Yes.
And I say, what if you first use imitation technique to adapt each sample motion to the robot dynamics, and then you learn
this data from sensor data. Because
maybe it doesn't make sense. But,
So the idea is I have a learning in which there is human data, and there is a learning in which there is this human data that has been corrected. And we have seen that from this human data, the motion was not feasible. We believe, we are not sure we want to test it, that if the learning is based on motion that has been acquired by the sensor data, so it's already, you know that it's feasible for a chapitre, maybe the result that we will obtain will be feasible or more feasible, maybe it's not feasible at the beginning, but will be a little bit changed. And so the compensation to make this motion feasible will be faster. We don't need a big compensation of motion.
Do you think you would be able to benefit from the learning for the lower part also?
I think so. But it could be interesting to try the both approach. Until now, we have seen that the lower body is not feasible, is not feasible for the robot. Yeah, if we extend the training set also considering the lower body, that we know that should be feasible for the robot, maybe, yes, we could also, by learning, we should generate directly the whole body motion. And maybe we don't need a walking pattern generator again and the dynamic filter. Okay. Or maybe we need them, but less, okay. For less compensation.
Okay, so concerning the final part. My colleagues, I find this part very elegant and very interesting. So it was clear that, okay, from the perception of the landmarks in the image space, you can control the robot. You don't need anything else. So it's from a static image.
Exactly, it's a static controller.
So one single image and you can...
One single image.
But one problem, of course, is so you can generate those trajectories passing through the door in these two ways you suggest. But for a real robot and a real environment, there are other questions. So, like passability, because the robot is not a punctual robot, it has some envelope, and because the door has. As a size. So can you maybe looking at the odometry of the robot and the motion of the landmarks in time, maybe you can say something about passability, or can you deal with these questions that would remain for a real robot?
So you this way. You mean to use the odometry of the robot to improve the
control? Not to improve. It's clear that you can control the robot so as to pass through the door. But you make a few assumptions. One is the robot is a punctual one, and the camera is a pinhole camera. Assuming you have a real robot and a real door, you also have to answer the question about passability. So is the door large enough for the robot?
Mm-hmm.
And is your trajectory straight enough close to the door to pass?
Of course, we should also analyze this aspect, because maybe the door is not big enough, or maybe the robot is moving too close to the landmark. We should check it. We didn't investigate so much on this problem, because we observed the results show that when we have a bipolar coordinate, the robot is exactly going to the middle of the door. And we suppose that the door is big enough for the robot. So if you are using, for example, the robot HRP2, of course, maybe we should check if the door is quite big enough. But the assumption is, okay, the robot is smaller.
So, yeah, it would be interesting to know, for example, to apply that to a closing gate. So do you have time to pass through or not?
Mm-hmm.
And so I would be interested in knowing if there is some way of doing that.
We didn't investigate on it. But of course, if, for example, we have a closing gate, we have a landmark that is moving, of course, the robot maybe will try to turn and going exactly to pass its force. But maybe what we could do, actually, when we have the two landmark, we use a parameter that is called A. A actually is the distance between the middle of the door and the landmark. So this parameter has been fixed. So we could extend and observe this parameter. I don't know if this controller will work with it, because in our controller, this parameter is fixed. So to answer to your question could be interesting, but right now, with this kind of controller, it's not possible.
Yeah, I understand that. And I think you need to have some time information. So not only one single image, but you need a couple of images to take conclusion on passability and this kind of things. And okay, a final question is about so in your manuscript, honestly, it's like a bomb. So you just drop at the very end. So it's the very last page of your manuscript. And you show it in one of your last slides. This comparison between this control technique, so the trajectories generated by these control techniques, and the data set from Arechavaleta. And it's very similar. So it's surprisingly similar. So I guess it does not come as such without doing anything, right? So there is certainly some parameter estimation here. And if you can tell more about the way you generate this.
So I didn't personally generate these trajectories. It has been done in simulation by Paolo Solaris. But actually, the gain of the controller were fixed. We observed them also with Olivier Stas, for example, and actually, they are similar, but not so much. For example, okay, in this case for elliptic coordinate we have that is this kind of turning, but we don't have it exactly the same way for the elliptic bipolar coordinates. So they are similar. The gain were fixed. Actually, the gain that we use are the one that we found in the experimental, in the real experiment, because in the in simulation, for example, Paolo gave me some game, but they were not working the real robot. And so we tried again to do the same simulation with the real game. And we observed these trajectories that are similar to the one of human, but they are not exactly identical. Mm-hmm. What could be interesting is to combine them and see if they are more similar to this one. The gain was fixed. We didn't change every time the gain to obtain...
We didn't have the need to adapt the parameters for each target position. For that.
No, because actually how you can see, for example, for bipolar coordinate, is really similar to the one of the other simulation. It's just turning. It's just going exactly to the middle of the goal and passing perfectly like a line. But this is not exactly what we have in the human. In human, it's much more similar to the elliptic coordinate. If you observe it, it is not a line, similar to here. Here, instead, it's a line.
And did you compare the velocity profiles for this pass?
No, but for sure the velocity profile that you have of the robot is lower, because actually what the control law was there when the robot was deaccelerating a lot when it was arriving to the door, it was actually stopping because we wanted it was stopping at the middle of the door. And accelerating a lot at the beginning. The maximal velocity, we found it in an elliptic coordinate that was around 0.8 meters per second. We know that human doesn't change so much their velocity when they are walking.
Okay.
The problem is that we tried to have higher velocity. Mm. But the problem was that we were losing the landmark. Because when the robot was turning a little bit, it was difficult to find again the landmark. And then, so there is always a compromise between velocity and to see the task.
Is it the reason why you want to investigate with the pan tilt camera?
Exactly. Okay. Because now the camera was fixed, but if we have the camera, it is turning to follow the landmark. Yeah. And actually, we know the orientation of the camera with respect to the one of the robot. We can. So we add a degree of freedom and can still compute the control law.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yes, so I will not ask any question. Just congratulate you for the nice presentation. Well done. I think it was much clearer and had to the manuscript. That was very nice. Just maybe a couple of precision for the jury with respect to slide 34.
34.
Yeah. And this one, so basically, actually, the data set was not used. The point is was to compress all the data set using this dynamical motion primitive, which are actually linearly coupled, and which to some degree has a generalization capability. I prefer to say interpolation. And one of the key points is when the plan is to use it when the weights and all the parameters are fixed and solved. So actually there were two phases, one which were to try to find the first set of solution from the human data set. And then the second point, which was to say, okay, which are the ones which are able to drive the robot and to generate a feasible motion. So to the question of Julien, which was a very interesting one, but to be honest, I think Christian spent a lot of time to solve all the, you know, all the technical stuff to make this being able to work. And honestly, his technical support, his kindness on making all this experimental stuff has to be really put forward. He went to run with all the robot, and so it was a lot of work. And he did that with always a good heart. Thanks for that. So just to come back to the point, so the projection to the feasible motion is quite complex, actually. And it's not that putting directly something which is feasible, each time you may have a different solution. The generalization for working is really not obvious at all. And we try that with another set of partners. And to be honest, the result is what we expected, that it doesn't work that well. We are very much unstable, the generalization capability are not so good. So we are much more hopeful that with this approach, like still learning a data-driven approach to drive and help the low-level controller, we can have something which can work finally on the robot.
And that's it. Thank you.
Okay, so in my turn, I congratulate you for this very nice presentation, because I know that you work a lot to improve it from the manuscript and give details on many points. And really, the presentation was clear, and I think that for the jury members, it's a way to better understand some details. So I will continue the comments. Olivier made some comments on this part. I will go back to the first part, the comment by Francesco. So initially, within the framework of Koroibot, when we started this problem of studying how behave a human when he is perturbated in his walking, we wanted to really have something really intrusive in the walk of the human and analyze the movement at the joint level. Because we had previous work with Manish Srinivasa on this topic, where really we analyzed which foot was used, from how much the head was turned, the shoulders and everything during the avoidance. So we wanted to start in this direction. But we had this meeting with Julien, where we discovered all the work they had previously done on this interaction, human-human interaction. And so we thought that as a first work, it would be nice to take the same protocol and first to go in this high level, just considering the human as a point with a direction. And so it took very, very much time that we thought, because we had to implement that on different kinds of robot, and there are all the protocols, all the motion capture, and all the steps. And really, Christian was occupied for a very long time, and many stays in Rennes, so we didn't go up to the final point. So this is the reason why we didn't go to the joint level, but this is something that we want still to do. And comments with respect to the last part of your work. I think now, Julien, you are in a team that is specialist on vision-based control. And we have been working on vision-based control here too for long. And if you go to the last slide,
okay.
If we want to control the a robot, the one with the trajectory, the human trajectories.
This one?
The one with the human trajectories.
Ah.
Yeah. This one. Perfect. If we want to control, for instance, Vivian Cadena knows it very well here. If we want to control a robot, a mobile robot, to go through a door with 2 points, then if we apply an exponential decay of the task, as we usually do in visual surveying, then the robot will go forward and will minimize the geodesic in terms of trajectory. And this is not what is observed here. The key idea of this work was still to do 2D vision-based control. That is, we only use information in the image plane, but the control law that are used by the robot follow some trajectory that take benefit from the fact that the 2 points are considered at foci of confocal curves. And then we obtain such trajectories, and this is due to the visibility, because the only task that we do is to maintain those 2 points in the image in a certain way, because the control is reacting in a certain way. And so we observe that maybe human can do, because even if we don't use the degrees of freedom at the neck, if we have this fixed camera and we want to maintain those 2 points in a kind of with a kind of reference position, then we will not move forward to 2 points. We will have such curved trajectory, and this is very strange. And so the work now will be to improve that. So I have one question
of course.
You. Uh-huh. And you said you make an opposition in the first part of your work with respect to the second, for instance, answering to Francesco. You said that in the first part you extract some principle invariant of human movement, behavior, and then you implement those invariant. And you said it's different from minimizing a criteria.
Yes.
Okay, don't you think that you minimize the criteria in a way?
I minimized the criteria, but I didn't define the problem in the same way.
Okay, but don't you think that in a certain space, the what is observed minimizes the criteria anyway?
To avoid the collision, you mean?
Yeah, the human-human behavior.
Of course, we can consider like minimize a path, so the energy. And the constraints are like the obstacles. So yes, in some sense, it's an optimization problem. What I want to say is that we didn't have the same approach, but it's so we try to solve the same optimization problem, but in a different way. But yes, of course, you're right. It's an optimization problem.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. President. Merci. Congratulations again for your presentation. And now this is the end of the presentation. And the committee, I don't know if we go outside.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so you can stay here.